And then it just bursts like a giant pimple.
Welcome to a very special episode of Black Sheep Rising. We are here live at Keenvention 2015.
Oh, it's special, all right.
And yeah, well, we had a huge audience, and then I guess they're all using the bathroom, Daryl?
They went to go eat lunch.
Yeah, and hopefully they'll be back and they'll catch some of our other guests. But this is being recorded, so you can watch it at your leisure. No big deal at all.
I actually had the same size audience yesterday when I recorded Peace, Love, Liberty Radio.
The regular
but
Rat
Pack.
But at
least the person in the audience now was paying attention. The guy that was in the audience yesterday was doing something on his laptop, and I don't think he even realized that I was on stage recording a podcast.
The regular Rat Pack is here. That guy talking.
They just throw a bunch of shit to the wall, and they see what sticks.
Of course, Daryl W. Perry, who is running for president, and I'm going to be voting for him, and you should too, because he is the only candidate of principle worth your while. Of course, the young lady in the third chair.
I have no soul.
Is Shauna Nash, of course. Thank you for being here. It's a hard time. I got to drag her butt on all the time. And hey, who is that?
Don't know.
None other than Katie McCall. We haven't seen you in a long old time.
I think the last time I was here was with Matt, right?
Yeah, it's a many episodes ago. Too bad.
Doesn't like us anymore.
Well, she
That's
lives out
true.
In the woods.
I got married.
It's quite yes. I was just about to say.
I know. I was there.
For all you gentlemen out there interested in the young thing on the end. Nope. Sorry, she's off the market. Someone put
Somebody
a ring on
liked
that
it,
thing.
They put a ring on it.
I saw your pictures. I saw your wedding pictures. I thought they were very nice. And then I found out last night that somebody. Because I was going to ask you, I was like, did you do it the legal way? Did you ask permission from the man? Or how did you get around it? What did you do?
I don't ask permission from any man.
Well, that's...
So, yeah, no. I didn't do it I did do it a legal way. It wasn't like it was illegal what I did. Maybe it was illegal what Daryl did.
Yeah, her and Michael standing up there and saying some stuff and putting rings on fingers and kissing, that was not illegal at all. But my presence there saying some words and saying, you know, like, this is Mr. and Mrs. Michael Anthony O'Day, that was technically illegal because they did not have a government permission slip. So I could be charged with a violation of the marriage laws, punishable by $60, which I would not pay, and I would gladly sit a day in the Cheshire County House of Corrections. I also did not charge them the mandated fee that is mandated in law. And I am guessing that the penalty for that is also $60. Okay, so I'll spend a weekend in jail. That sounds like a good vacation.
Well, hello, Mr. Fancy Pants.
Well, that's really long. So, Katie, how you been? Are you still doing your thing? Are you still pulling the babies out?
I don't pull any babies out, but yeah, I'm still catching.
You're easing them out and catching them with your catcher's mitt.
My catcher's mitt, and the babies that are flying through the air.
Are you still having classes where you actually instruct the ladies and guys, I guess, on how to better?
I am still teaching occasionally, and my midwifery practice has been picking up a bit, so that's been the majority of my busyness. Mm-hmm. And then I now have two chefs living in my house because Matt Roach obviously is still there. And
that's right, he does pizzas for a living or something.
Yeah, well,
days.
He does now, but he don't let him fool you. He was a really amazing chef in his day.
Oh, he's amazing. The dinner that he cooked for the wedding, it was like some cheese rice stuffed inside a chicken wrapped in bacon and potatoes.
Wrapped in bacon. That was the important part.
And like bacon, like that's really the chicken wrapped in bacon is amazing in and of itself. And the cheese rice inside of it, that was so many carbs, but it was so tasty.
And you also, I guess you've changed locations as well. You
We were renting Stone Farm.
A very beautiful place.
Yeah. So now I own Stone Manor, which is a property in the same town, just in town, bigger, better maintained, more bed and breakfast rooms, and married another chef. So now I have two chefs in the house to do breakfast and hospitality. And so
you can
walk
to town hall from where you live.
Winning.
I can, and Matt Roach does every single week to keep an eye on the selectmen.
Yeah, I wish we had a smaller group of individuals to keep our eyes on. We've got a bunch of them because we're in a city.
Yeah, we have three, and I was surprised because we did go to one meeting once because they sent us a letter saying that we had to not do business anymore. So we had to go down and sit.
Meet us, please.
Yeah, exactly. And so I thought it was going to be, a small town hall meeting, a small selectman meeting. I was not prepared for the fact that they were the only people there, were the three selectmen, and they had to pull out folding chairs for us.
Yeah, that's typical. Yeah, they probably weren't expecting.
Here's some chairs.
They're like, oh, we weren't even going to bring the chairs out.
Right.
We keep them in the corner,
so
and
now
if anyone shows
week,
up, you can get them yourselves.
Every week they pull out the one obligatory chair for Matt Roach, and he sits there and stares at them, and they say, is there something you wanted to add?
Do you know if he has any plans to live stream their meetings or record them and put them on YouTube?
I don't know that.
The reason I ask is because there's somebody in Alstead that has started live streaming all of the selectmen's meetings.
Oh, nice.
And I think that it would be interesting to see more people in small towns doing that.
That's actually really so. I'll have
to
ask him.
In Keene, all of the city council meetings and the different commissions and boards of the city council, those meetings are all broadcast live on community access television. Yeah. So they all go out on Cheshire TV, same place people can watch Black Sheep Rising here in Keene. The school board meetings for Keene School District and the Monadnock School District wind up going out live. And I don't think the selectmen meetings in Swansea or Marlboro wind up getting recorded or broadcast, but I would love to see more people doing that. Of, hey, we realize nobody probably wants to see this, but here it is if you do.
I don't know if you guys know that Matt Roach was elected for something.
Oh, really?
What?
Yeah.
Share some gossip.
Go ahead.
He was elected to the board of the Historical Society for Fitzwilliam.
Nice.
Which I think is not technically a government position, but it's a government-funded position. And so he's slowly trying to make his way into Fitzwilliam politics, I think.
Nice. Congratulations, Mr. Roach.
So it was a landslide, too. And he never said anything. Nobody even knew who he was. He was just comparing him to the other guy.
Typically the way it works.
A lot of times in these small towns, all you have to do is show up and say, hey, I'm willing to fill a vacancy. And they're like, okay, so we've got five vacancies. Which ones do you want?
Right, yeah. Fresh meat.
So, all right, so now what's new? What's new on the table? What are your plans for the future? Are you just going to keep on keeping on?
We're going to keep on keeping on. We have been. Probably the newest thing on our plate has been my son's decision to unschool. So
yeah,
that
I just heard you talking about that on the panel. He, what grade was he in?
Eighth grade. And he is now experiencing what I affectionately call a drowning in liberty. So he's on the other side playing video games 24/7 until he pukes. And he is slowly getting to a place where he's starting to calculate together the hours that he spent playing video games and figuring out how many days he would be dying early if he subtracted that from his life. So it's starting to creep in.
I did something similar with how often I sleep. You're sleeping 1-2 hours too long every day, and this is how much of your life you're missing out on.
So since he's playing video games, is he recording himself play video games? Because I know like that's a popular thing for people to watch people play video games.
Get those nerds!
Yeah, he's big fans of all those people, but he is he does not have the fundage to procure that kind of equipment, and that kind of income would require working. Which would require him stopping the video game playing.
But
to
like you can get a webcam
money.
For like $30.
Yes, but you have to have $30.
Okay.
And you've got to be good at the game you're playing too.
Yeah, which he's pretty good at the games. It's just, you know, he'd have to stop playing long enough to go rake leaves or.
No. You don't have to be that good. Have you ever seen the React channel to where they have random people play video games and people will watch like. Here's some idiot playing a video game that they've never played before, and they get millions of hits.
Yeah. Actually, my kids have, they try to show them to me. I watch them for about 2 seconds, and I'm like, you watch this for how long? You know, they're just screaming at it. Ah! You know, I'm like, you watch this? It's, you know,
well, if you want someone to watch your channel and follow you, you need to have something, some ideal quality that people want to come back and see. Maybe you're a good.
Okay, so
maybe you play like crap, but you're a good commentator, and you're actually
right. Mm-hmm. So it could be like, here's how bad I am at every video game there is, mm-hmm. and you intentionally do horrible. Isn't that what that weird, goofy, Swedish guy, PewDiePie?
Yes.
Like he's an annoying ass fuck.
Yeah.
That doesn't know how to play video games, yeah. but he's got millions of people that watch his shit.
But yeah. his YouTube name is PewDiePie, which sounds really cute, and it's like a dumb guy. Like the same thing if you're a chick and your voice is really feminine, you gotta cuss like a fucking sailor. And that's like a thing that people think is neat. Or if you're a dude and you have a regular dude voice, you gotta say, oh gosh. I died again. And that was like a shtick or something.
My kid's favorite one is, my daughter's favorite one is Cryotic. I don't know if you know that one. He's a masked individual on YouTube where he never shows his face, but
it's not a visual
thing.
Maybe it's about
same
15
voice.
People.
Yeah, that could be.
That's but a I'm that lot guy? Of energy.
No, isn't that Carmina Burana?
No, that is it's from The Omen, so I don't know.
Oh,
I don't know who did that one.
Sure, that sounded a lot like Carmina Burana.
There you go.
Yeah, there you go. That's Carmina Burana.
I actually got to see some clowns do that.
Video game playing.
No, it's the
Carl Orff's Carmina Burana, the whole thing.
The whole scene, the whole setup.
Yeah.
And of course
like actual clowns with like clown makeup and poofy hair.
They're actually professionals.
That would be cool.
They're actually professionals. And no, they did the entire set, and of course that is the first and the last scenes.
Mm-hmm.
Everything else in between is just kinda ugh.
Yeah.
It's just a lot of monk chanting kind of stuff, mm-hmm. and it was getting stale.
Yeah,
because it all sounds the same. I guess you could actually understand whatever they're singing in Latin,
mm-hmm.
It might make more sense. But I don't speak Latin.
Yeah,
at all.
They're kind of just repeating themselves.
So you were just on stage. You did a little the ladies of Liberty, or what was it called?
Ladies panel.
And we were listening to you go on about. It was a lot of talking about creepers. Talking about you just
I didn't have a whole lot to contribute to the creeper part. I think it's my age. I don't know.
That's because you found yourself a
not quite so fresh meatish.
But like some people will define creeper to be any guy that I don't find attractive that talks to me.
Right. Well, and that's the one thing I was going to possibly add a little to there is. I live with two men who one of them was single, so there were two single men. And
I don't know if you could consider him single. He was dating you. Like you two
no,
were
but,
in a relationship.
Okay, no,
so
but I'm speaking to their experience. He was not dating me his entire life. But I'm saying that the feedback that I would get from them sometimes was, you know, that it was really hard to approach libertarian women because you can't know that they're not interested until they tell you they're not interested,
right.
But then if they aren't interested, then automatically they're like perceived as a creeper.
Yeah.
Although, they were giving a good, you know, on stage, they were giving a good definition of, you know, somebody who persists beyond that point.
Right.
You know,
but that's how the four people on stage define it.
Right.
I mean, don't all women want to be pursued anyways? So, I mean, it kind of sounded like one being a woman, being a pretty woman in the Liberty Movement was terrible. And also... like
it's the greatest thing ever because you've got all these guys that want to date you and you get your choice.
And you get to, you know, act, I don't know, poorly, but you slide on being a chick, which you know, I'd take it if you want it, but yeah, the creeper thing sounded like it was going back and forth, particularly, I guess, because it was focused on one incident that would not be named, but everybody kind of knew about it.
Everybody knew who they were talking about.
Who they were not talking about.
No, only attractive females knew who they were talking about. So, right?
I
think that's how that.
Oh, this was
talking about.
Okay. It just wasn't me. I'm just outside of the. I'm always outside of the drama.
You live too far out in the woods.
I do. I live in the woods, but I do it on purpose. You know, because you know it's nice to not be in the drama. I like
it
my
saves
boring
a lot
life.
Of time. It really does.
I really do like my boring life.
The joys of being a hermit.
The joys. No, you know that book was already written. The New Hampshire Hermit. There's a story about him. And he lived in New Hampshire, and he lived all by himself. And there was this whole book written about, you know, how wonderful his life was being a hermit. But I'm not a hermit. I just prefer not to be involved in the dramatic. I like my boring life. So.
Amen. Amen to boring people.
Yep.
And then something else that was mentioned during the ladies panel, and I thought about asking a question on, but then figured, you know, like that'll go into more like relationship talk sort of thing. Was one of the panelists kept mentioning about gender roles, and you know, like gender roles sort of need to be thrown out the window. But most Liberty ladies, they still want the, you know, more traditional gender role. Like, I want the guy who, even though I don't necessarily need him to provide, I want him to be suitable and this and that. You know, so like, they seek a mate that follows traditional gender roles. They just want to say, like, well, gender roles are dead, but they still follow them a good bit. So do you have thoughts on that?
Looks like Shauna did for a second. It was fleeting.
I thought your answer on the whole, are gender roles real or something, or whatever it was, I thought that was the closest one that was the best, well thought out, I guess. I mean, everybody had a lot of stuff to say. And I think what Daryl's recognizing is that there's a tendency to be cool, especially in the Liberty movement, the Liberty social scene, to say, no, equal is good, equality is good, people want to be treated equally and all that. But the privileges of being in a chick are pretty damn sweet, and it's not cool to say that, to admit that. And I don't know where people go with that, except for just repeating over and over that it's really equal, but at the same time, and then you end up just talking in circles, and I don't know where else to go with it, or why.
Why are we fighting?
Right? Oh, I'm always throwing you off. Keep on, Shauna. Keep on.
No, I'm done.
She's all, and it's, I'm
that's,
done.
You know, really what I thought about
two
it.
Two things, buddy.
Yeah. No, I think that's very true, and I think that most of the conversation around gender roles seems to happen between men and single women. There's not a lot of women with children that are asked that question, and that may be why my answer was more thought out, because I've had twice the life years to think it out,
right,
plus, and to experience different things.
Plus, as you said, you live with two chefs, and you know, a lot of the best,
and I make all the money. So
a lot of the best chefs actually are men,
right?
But people generally think of, well, cooking is a woman's job,
right? Yep.
But you know,
oh
like
man, they would both look at you and be like, oh no, please don't have Katie
cook circles around you.
Yes.
And yeah,
my children won't starve. I can cook. I just am not a chef. And both of these men in my house are not just chefs. They're amazing chefs. And so it's
bacon wrapped chicken.
And he didn't come up with that. The stuff that he's
came
up
with it or not, he cooked it and it was amazing.
No, but it's what's really amazing is when a chef can take somebody else's suggestion of what should be done and makes it really, really
like
good.
I've never walked into the grocery store and seen chicken that was already pre-wrapped in bacon.
No.
So like, you know,
he did all
he made
that.
That.
Yes, he did. And you know, everybody has their like one or two things that they're really good at cooking. Like,
you didn't build that. Somebody else made that happen.
Somebody else made.
Obama
that.
Doesn't believe in
Obama.
Matt
Roach. Obama gets his bacon wrapped chicken. He wants his bacon wrapped chicken back. you know, everybody has like the one or two things that they're good at making. Like, you know, they'll both tell you, I can make really good enchiladas, right? I basically can only make Mexican food because I'm from LA. There we go. There's
enchiladas
my
are not sandwiches.
No, they're not sandwiches. But to have somebody who's a chef take something that they don't normally make or have never made before, and the fact that they can make that good, that's
right.
Impressive.
Outstanding.
Absolutely.
So I guess that's...
did we address gender roles all the way?
Gender roles.
I think.
We used them up. Creepers, and they need to go away. The thing about the...
they need to go
creepers.
Away. I like the
because,
Minecraft
because
creeper.
I know the women's like to be pursued, and they like to know that they're attracted and attracted... And right. are people interested in them.
And men, too, likewise.
But sometimes dudes with usually libertarian types, you know, living in their closets their whole lives types, aren't open to those types of cues. They don't get it.
Right.
And so they
this is what's really funny because my husband.
But they got TV telling them one thing and say, I got to keep pursuing them. Otherwise,
right.
I'm never going to get it.
I think libertarians in general should just relax and just do what they do because my husband, who, like I said, is a native libertarian, the only reason I went on a second date with him was because he made absolutely no attempt whatsoever to kiss me or give me a hug or anything. After an awesome... No, and that's the funny thing. After the fact, I was like, either he wasn't interested and the conversation was really good, but I just got like friendship zoned or, you know, I couldn't figure it out. Come to find out now that I know him better, he was just way too awkward and had no idea what the hell to do. So he just ran for the bar. It was all he did. He was like, all right, bye. It was great talking to you. See you later. And took off. And I was like, what? No. Now we will have a second date, you know. So maybe libertarian men just need to, you know, chill out and just be themselves.
Or not overload the woman with information about where this is going, what exactly is going on.
Don't overanalyze it.
Because then if we already know, then... the chick doesn't care anymore because they already know.
Yeah.
And there are some libertarians that they think that every conversation has to be a conversation about liberty.
Right.
Like we can't just, you know, like talk like two normal people about, you know, like what's happening in your life? What's happening in my life? Yeah. Did you watch any movies recently? You know, this, that, the other thing. Like, you know, let's talk about life.
I watched this documentary about Bitcoin. It's going to take off.
It's like, you know, no, we're going to talk about Murray Rothbard, and I'm going to tell you all the reasons that Murray Rothbard is Jesus, and
maybe
Ron Paul is the Holy Spirit. And
maybe that's why most of my really close friends here are all like from here and have cows and milk them and, you know, hang them up to drain their blood.
But there was somebody on the panel.
I don't know anybody with pigs, actually. Oh, no, that's right. Yes.
There was somebody on the panel that had a good idea that maybe there should be some sort of like singles meet and greet sort of
thing. I think
because
Maria brought that up.
You know, my thinking is like, oh, okay, female, she must have a boyfriend.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe there's one that doesn't. I don't know.
I imagine there's actually quite a few that
or
don't.
Or maybe everybody who's single could wear like an armband with like
or put a dot on their forehead.
Well, no.
All be rounded up into the concentration camp.
And in Manchester, at least, just because somebody has a boyfriend doesn't mean that they're not available too.
So, right.
Right.
Yeah, and that whole thing, like, I'm what you would
like
consider like
also.
Polycurious to where like I'm interested in like, you know, how it all works, but like I don't know. So like
I like to live far away from the drama.
There's a group on Facebook that's the polyamorous community.
Yep.
And so I asked the question, like, you know, how do you know if it's okay? And they're like, well,
it's when the music comes
on. You don't necessarily know. Like, you know, sometimes you have to ask the partner and sometimes you don't. And it's like...
if it's 3 a.m. and you find yourself behind some closed doors with that music playing, then yes.
It must be right.
It must be available.
Makes too much sense.
But no, so like for me, I cannot remember the last time I asked a woman out on a date. And it would be even weirder to be like, hey, Conan, I really like your girlfriend. Can I ask her out on a date? And apparently, like, that's the procedure.
I think the procedure is the other way around where Conan would ask you to go on a date with his girlfriend. Maybe that's the...
I think
right, but he might not know
that
I'm interested.
Is that chattel? Is that when, like,
I think we need a cult master to like, allocate...
Now, I did see something hilarious.
Like, hold on. You've been in the community for how long?
And you,
I was going to say, this really is a libertarian issue, though, because we want procedure. Like, this needs to be logical.
Mm-hmm.
We want a logical procedure of how this works. And relationships don't happen that way.
Who's going to make those decisions?
That's what I'm saying.
If you're going to have a cult master who sits down and says, all right, look, you guys have been together too long. You need to, you know.
Mix it up. Mix it up.
You need to branch out a little bit and, you know, socialize outside of your little group.
Yeah, yeah.
And so now we're depending on some dude to make that decision?
No.
It's just silliness.
That's not going
to
happen.
No, not a dude. We need a computer program, and it needs to be on the blockchain.
Oh, no.
Everything needs to be on the technology.
Yes. Von Mises wrote it in his secret diaries.
Satoshi dating Bitcoin.
All right, Steve.
Get on that. Well, my advice to you about Polly, Daryl, which I have so much advice to give to you about Polly, because I really think it's a real thing, is, you know, don't ask in a group of how everybody would do things at once, because it's so, you know, you're asking, like, what do you feel you would do in the situation? Everybody has to set up the situation. And I would advise you in your polyamorous adventures that I can advise you on.
don't do it.
Well, that's already implied. but just go with each individual interaction.
Right.
Like, if you're interested in some chick or somebody and you're like, well, you tell me what is the situation, or, you know, read some game blogs and be like, neg them all into, you know, lapping at your feet. Watch Donald Trump. You'll learn.
Donald Trump has the best quotes.
You'll fire it.
He's gaming the whole damn
Sean,
states.
Of course, follows Donald's tweets. And I don't know how she...
Speaking of tweets, I found out about this thing called Nihilist Arby's earlier today.
Yes, you did. You found out about that.
And I never knew that that was... No, it was through
I've been posting
Brett
a couple
Benatt.
Of them.
It was through Brett Benatt. And I was like, what? And apparently it's somebody that runs a parody thing where one of them was about as you suck your way through all of the crack-addicted dicks in the men's bathroom, just remember that you're going to die at some point in the end of your life.
Was
Enjoy
almost a
Arby's.
Clean show.
I'm so confused.
It's just a funny Twitter
just
that we'll link it.
Arby's on
oh,
Twitter.
It's a Twitter. Okay.
It's a Twitter account.
I was like,
so if you have the time
are
of the day
we talking? I must have zoned out at some point, and then all of a sudden
out.
There was crack addicted. What? So, yeah, sorry.
Enjoy Arby's.
Why wouldn't Polly be chicks censored? Be under me?
Yes, I know. Yeah. I can't figure out why I can't
care
get dates
all those
with
dicks I sucked, you know, in Arby's.
Yes. And they were all crack addicted.
So now everybody from the audience is moving closer because they heard crack addicted dicks.
I believe it's Ellen's turn. Right?
No, Katie, thank
They're
you
like,
so
wait,
much.
Yes, crack addicted
so
dicks?
We
must find out more.
For being
so
on. All right, where's your site where people can find out about, it's not Stone Farm anymore.
No, now it's Stone Manor because we don't have 40 acres. We have a bigger house. We don't have as much land.
But
so it's Stone Manor. Still open bed and breakfast. We actually expanded it. So there's three rooms now. One of them has a private bathroom for all the lovebirds. And it's much quieter and more private. And it's on Facebook. You just type in Stone Manor.
Stone Manor.
And if
you still have a blog technically, but you've not updated that in a long time.
No, I haven't. I'm a catalyst who really fails at follow through. So I start things and I hope people pick them up. And if they don't, they just die. They just die.
The people or the things?
You just
Both.
Like to try so
okay.
many things. You
Enjoy
just
Arby's.
You don't have all the hours in the day
I do.
To
it's
do them
my
all.
Brain is just all over the place. But thank you so much for having
thanks,
me.
Thanks
and
for being
it's
on.
Good. It's always good to see Conan, who I
You missed
almost
the great
never.
Fire last night.
I know. Oh. And you know what? I really wanted to go.
Conan
and
didn't fall
I
into
guess.
The fire this time.
Did you fall into the fire last time?
I don't remember what happened last time.
No,
oh,
he
must have fallen
into
the
fire. But he fell out of a chair.
It sounds
and
like a really
he
good
fell
80s
down the
song.
Stairs and he lost his glasses.
Oh no!
Danger zone!
It's just like a just sharp glass everywhere. And
ow!
I don't know. That's what they told me.
Oh,
I
did that on New Year's
I
Eve.
I monitored my drinking.
He couldn't
this
sit
time.
Down for about a week.
Oh, ouch.
Okay, thanks
yes.
so much for being on.
Yeah, no problem. It was
We're
going to
hand
you guys.
It right over to Miss Ellen Ball, who has also disappeared off into the boonies. You guys, man, you come and you hang out. Where's Ellie's drops? Ellen's. There you go.
Oh, now it's just way too big.
What was that?
Got a couple of drops from her when she was last on. So, yeah, everyone who's going to be on this this panel has been past panelists who have escaped, who have disappeared. Ellen, how are you, man?
I'm great. I'm doing wonderful. I'm going to college.
Yeah, I heard
house.
That. So you're actually, so we're always bitching and complaining about the college system and how it's a scam. I guess unless you actually pick a degree that's actually going to work for you in the end. But I mean, because the money, the investment is just, it's so much.
Yeah, and that's definitely true. But probably the biggest contributor to the college scam is kids picking colleges not based on what they can afford, but mm-hmm. based on just like the name of the school and how
prestigious
it is.
Or where it ranks on the list of party schools.
Yeah, or that.
Yeah, if you're picking your college, yeah, that's...
Have pumpkin riots.
And that list is right. out there, too, which ones have the best parties. And if you're picking
your Playboy does that list.
Yeah, so I'm horrible. Going to a college where they don't have dormitories, so you just go there for classes, which makes it a whole lot cheaper.
Commuter college.
Yeah, pretty much. What, drive an hour to and from.
And your degree?
I'm going for an associate's in chemistry right now, but after I get that, I'm probably going to get a job and help... No, what? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it's
hey,
true.
Someone's got to do it. I mean, all right, is this something you like, or did you look at a list of things that are lacking, the declining jobs?
She heard Barack Obama say that we need to get more women into the STEM programs, and she was like, chemistry, that's definitely STEM, so I'll do that.
Yeah, that's what it was. Also, actually, it's really kind of screwed up because at my school, they have a list of programs that are non-traditional for women, and chemistry is not on there because I guess Marie Curie just like ruined it for all women.
Oh yeah, didn't
she knew
she
what she was
polio?
Doing. No, I think what she did was she discovered
cheese,
uranium. I think it was uranium. It was one of those radioactive
right. yellow
elements.
Cake. She yes. made yellow cake.
For real?
And then
she stood over a boiling
then,
pot for
the,
months.
The other Marie Antoinette said, "Let them eat cake." And because Marie Curie invented yellow cake, they had cake that they could eat during the French Revolution. That's why they beheaded Louis the 16th.
Oh my God! I'm glad you put that all together for us.
We should totally do an episode of Drunken History to where you just get me drunk and I talk random shit that doesn't make any sense.
I don't think I've ever seen
you drunk. We don't need to get you drunk to do that. You can do that sober.
We need you to just listen to Drunken History and then you do an episode of Drunken History. Only just like switch out the words and get like a dub in. So you're talking about the French Revolution and it's like, and then they killed Charles II. At the end of the French Revolution.
Charles II wasn't French.
Exactly. That way both our jokes make sense.
Did you look at a list, and how did you come up with your degree is what I want to know.
So I've always been interested in science, and when I got into high school, I found out that I really, really like chemistry. And I mean, I really, really like some other topics as well, but you can't really make a living making art. Unless you're really famous or, have the right publicity.
Yeah, Van Gogh did not make a living making art. He only sold like one painting in his lifetime.
Yeah,
he
had a really sad life.
Which is why he chopped off his ear and then killed himself.
Yeah, so chemistry, I really like it, and it makes a decent amount of money. So
you're going to go work for Big Pharma, aren't you?
No.
Monsanto. She's going to get a job with Monsanto and then change the whole genetically modified corporatist farmer thing from the inside.
If you want to fix Big Pharma, you got to get a job and work from within to
and get me some script paper.
That's what everyone thinks, but I don't think you can really change from the inside unless you're like CEO or something.
What will you do to make medicinal magic mushrooms a reality in the next 5 years?
I don't know. I can mass produce the spores and then just pass them out. Just throw them up in the clouds and there you go.
I think we need to work on weed first and get that.
Well, you know all those
get that stabilized before we start working on MDMA and
those chemtrails up in the sky could just replace that with like the mushroom spores.
Yes.
Ooh.
Work
now
on
we're
that.
Talking.
Yeah. Okay. If anything, I'm probably gonna go for big oil companies because oil is like the blood that courses through the economy's veins. So I don't know. That's probably better to me than working for pharma. But genetic engineering would be fun, too, because then you could make, like, super species.
with the there's some sort of weird larva thing that will eat something and then like poop out some kind of thing that can be used as diesel. Yeah, it's kind of like that.
Oh, genetically engineered bacteria that eat fuel. They use those.
Like they
in
eat something and
spills.
Turn it into fuel. No, there's something that it eats something and turns it into fuel. So like you can make synthetic.
What do you
oil.
Mean, like
no,
poop
it's
cakes?
The nuts in the mouth.
What were they eating, Daryl?
They're eating just like random stuff, and it turns it into fuel.
Steak.
They're eating steaks.
What are you? Where did you hear this? And what is this? Is this genetically engineered?
It's some kind
organisms?
Of bug thing that was probably genetically engineered. Like everything's fucking genetically engineered. Depending
Dude,
on how you
engineered.
Define genetically engineered.
Like, I'm sure Daryl would want to be genetically engineered if he could choose. See, this is the future. People are going
to
be taking.
I do not welcome our robot overlords. I don't want to. I am not a transhumanist. I don't want to live forever.
I do want to live
don't
forever.
Don't force me into the Borg.
Yeah, I do too.
No, not going to force you into anything. But
you
like,
need to embrace the future, Daryl.
You
otherwise,
can't,
you're going to
so
fade
say
away to
you,
nothingness.
Say you knew your parents before you were born. Not you personally, but somebody.
Hold on, are you asking me to pretend to be Batman? Because like his
sure.
parents died when he was
sure,
a kid.
Sure, whatever you
so,
want
like,
to call
pretend
it.
Pretend that he knew his parents. Okay.
All right. So pretend you knew your parents before you were born. If you could say, "I want to be born without this certain characteristic," wouldn't you want them to like take that out? Like knowing what you know now, would you be like, "I don't want this"? Like maybe it's some physical ailment that you have that you would like to get rid of. Or that you would like to have not been born with.
Clumsiness that causes me to get a concussion every time I turn around.
So,
it's
more
not
coordination?
A tumor.
More coordination?
I'm not sure I understand.
Yes, you would
the
like
question.
To remove. Just say it, yes. I want to move bad characteristics from me because I want to be a better, more perfect person.
If, right, but like I still don't understand the question because like before I was born, I wasn't. There to be able to speak.
No, but this is a hypothetical. You can use imagination.
Imagine you had all the toothpicks in the world and you could take out any of that.
Imagine all the people living in harmony.
So is that one of the memes of...
Now we've got karaoke.
So is that one of the memes of something that you study is... genetic engineering
it's
is
related. Mostly it's just stuff I'm interested in, but
you're not gonna be doing a whole lot of that in the working for oil.
No,
and
this
how
is
much chemistry how much chemists do they actually need unless you're talking about the
all the chemists
the worms that
they
Daryl are
they
talking
do need
about.
People for process control and materials engineering. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that there's going to be new methods of fuel extraction developed in the next few decades, so
super fracking.
Yeah.
I drink.
Where they
your
just take like a giant
milkshake.
Asteroid from space and slam it into the earth, and then all of the oil just lands on the surface neatly in barrels, and humanity is destroyed.
Or the asteroid has a laser that shoots a beam into this hot spot of oil on the ground, and then it just bursts like a giant pimple.
That's how Alderaan exploded.
Alderaan? What are you talking about?
Star Wars.
Oh, okay.
There was a giant laser that
I finally got
shot into Alderaan, and it
I
went
finally
boom.
Got Shauna to watch the 4, 5, and 6.
Ooh, how did that go?
Yeah, it was painful.
I could
having
not
to
leave.
Drag her through that, and she was the whole time.
I can't rent anywhere else.
I could
else.
Not leave.
Had to keep her awake.
They're horrible
you were holding
movies.
A prisoner?
They're not.
Yes,
because cool.
it's.
Nope. They're really
who
bad.
Who shot first?
Doesn't matter. They're horrible movies.
Yeah, I agree.
Invented
I don't really
to
care.
Like more rottenize how horrible baby boomers were and now millennials, and they're horrible movies. The acting is shit. They're not interesting stories. They're just horrible.
Wow.
It's really
you're
sad.
Gonna get all emails sent to directly to Shauna, Black
Sheep
Rising
square,
at Shauna.
The square circle jerk at blackSheepRising.org.
All right,
sure.
So I just want to ask
they're horrible
what
movies.
Is your idea of a like the best movie ever? Like, what's the greatest movie you've ever seen?
At this point, I could draw circles with my eyes on the carpet after watching the Star Wars movies, and that would be,
but
like,
but what's
a
good
great
movie?
Not
are there any good movies?
There are good movies.
Or is everything we watch, I'm having to drag you through?
Do you have to drag her through everything because you have a weird sense of whatever of what's good?
All right, so a movie that you like.
She won't watch Downton Abbey with me. She says that's horrible. She doesn't want to see British drama. It's cool. It's a cool show. Daryl, are you familiar?
No, I'm vaguely aware that it's a show, but I've never watched it.
So we were.
I would much rather watch Vikings.
I know that's. I couldn't stand that. I watched one show and I was like, nah, this is retarded.
Dude, Shield Maidens. That's all you need to know. Shield Maidens.
So basically,
these
I just want to say,
hit and fuck you.
What?
Exactly.
See, I have it all figured out.
So
I should be on the men's panel next year.
I could almost agree with you, Shauna, about Star Wars, if I knew what kind of movies you find is good. Because I've never heard anyone say Star Wars is bad. That's like really shocking to me.
Well,
and
the ones
you
they
need
just
to read
did.
Some links.
One, two, and three are bad. 4, 5, and 6 are they're
so 4, 5, and 6 were
time.
The ones that were made back in
the '80s.
Back in the '70s and eighties.
Okay.
Those are the ones that I watched, was the ones in the '70s and eighties.
They're only bad because they didn't have the CGI that we have now. And
no,
they were bad.
They're horrible stories.
They're horrible stories. They're for children. There
the
was
stories
good
are meant
before.
To teach something, though.
Teach
like,
what?
That
you're
George
really
Lucas
special
can
if you
fuck
believe
you
it.
Out of billions of dollars. That's what they teach.
I don't know. They're imaginative. That's all I can say for them.
It's all. It's really forced. It's really, really forced.
Okay, so back to the what is a good show? Are there any good programs out there? Do they
Black
exist?
Sheep Rising is the best thing on television.
So right. here's my. So we go through Netflix, of course, and we're looking for. Programs that might, you know, be entertaining.
It takes longer to find a show on Netflix than it does to watch one.
And we watched like 3 episodes or so, and she was not digging it, but I couldn't tell. She's just, you know, she's my prisoner. She's getting dragged through this. And I guess we're almost done with the series, and she finally admits to it, says, I can't stand that show. I'm like, what?
The show's satanic.
I would have watched this. I could have, because we only watched like one show an evening.
So why
we dragged
did you
this
put
out. Some people watch
that?
A season in a day.
I didn't.
Because
I said,
he sent her a text that said Netflix and chill, and she was just sitting there chilling.
Look at his hair, man. Come on, I'll watch Kit Russ's stupid show. Sure. no, I actually.
It's not a text. It's a. Shut up! Netflix!
And chill.
No, I actually said I didn't want to watch the rest of that stupid show, and I'll, you know. You
but
can
by
watch
then,
the
we only had
it.
A couple episodes left, so
no,
we
it
had
was
to
like,
finish it.
It was like by the second show. I was like, this is horrible and satanic and should be illegal, and it brainwashes. It's just has all the worst themes that everybody's already imbued with anyway, so it doesn't
what
really matter.
What was the show?
Gotham.
Baby Batman.
Never seen it.
I'm Batman.
You're not missing much. Watch the first season of Peaky Blinders instead.
Of what?
Peaky Blinders.
Peaky Blinders, yeah.
Never
it's
heard
actually
of it.
An incredible show, I think.
Don't bother with season 2.
Once again, having to drag her through. So I watched the first season.
You guys need to watch Total Divas.
And I'm like, dude, this is so good. Season 2 had come out. I'm like, I can't start season 2 until you watch season 1.
You know
so
what show is
like
really great? Star
Vikings.
Trek.
The Dog Trek?
Star Trek.
Boggy Dilemmas?
No.
Which one? The old All right, one, the
I've
new
just
one.
Started watching the original series like a few
Nine.
Months ago. No, I started with the original series.
Did you watch the first
but it
one
wasn't
when
called
it's
called the original series?
When it's like only like 2 guys are the norms and everyone else is like pilot actors, and that was their one time on Star Trek.
Yeah, that first episode with Captain Pike. That I was kind of baffled by that. Like, where did this guy go? And then he shows up in a later episode as just a robot with a head. So it kind of goes full circle, but it was so, I don't know, like the ideas were ahead of its time, where it goes into like other dimensions and time travel and you know, these life forms that we can't even detect because we don't know how they function. Like all that stuff was just really, it's imaginative even to think about now, but you know, like 60 years ago, that's incredible. Like, and I was amazed
with
they had a low budget and did pretty well with it, except all the settings kind of looked like, you know, the same thing.
Yeah, I will admit that the reason I like, because I will watch Star Trek, but I'm not like a huge fan. I like the movies that just came out, especially the one with the huge false flag incident where the general was trying to save humanity, and the only way he could do it was to create this huge ship. I'm sorry. You guys haven't seen it, have you?
No.
I have no clue what you're talking about.
I'll stop talking.
Spoiler.
About it. It's not that big of a spoiler, but it's so sciency, and whereas Star Wars is more at one time it was kind of more swords and magic, and you know old empires, and it was more about the characters' interaction with each other instead of in Star Trek. It's like, yeah, it's science, and this is what's going to...
Well, some people say the show's really campy, like it follows a particular format, but I like that it has really strong character roles, especially with, like, Captain Kirk and Spock and Dr. McCoy. Like, one of them's, like, grumpy all the time. The other one's, like, super logical and always has, you know, like, the best strategy to figure out any problem, so and then all, the other one's really passionate.
Strengths. They all have their weaknesses, yeah, and they right. can't ever succeed. I would like to succeed as well.
Was Spock a libertarian?
Unless they get together.
Yeah,
really annoying. Never got the joke.
He didn't
super
start
logical everything. To the point of destroying relationships.
He didn't start as one. He was a logitarian. But then when you watch the movies, when his whole battle within himself was the taking care of the whole unit. It's, you know, an individual can be sacrificed in order to save the whole unit. And as the movies progress, he comes to the understanding that no, it's the basic building block is the individual, and that's what is most important. And then the bigger unit can survive from that. But no, Vulcan philosophy is it's the whole that counts. Not the individual.
So which, do you which, think that a lot sucks. Of the people that are, you know, for lack of a better term, often called Aspies, do you think they're basically trying to be Vulcans? This no. must make sense completely no. 100% of the time, and you are using feelings to influence your decision, so therefore that's not logical.
All right, but unlike Spock... you know, they can't do massive calculations in their head. They're not like 100%
logical. Tell them that.
They're totally Rain human. There's no green blood pulsing through their veins.
Toothpicks. Yeah, that's and he can count cards as well. So he's an Ospie with great intelligence and great mental capabilities. But I don't think that they're trying to be Vulcan, Daryl. I think they're trying to get by in life. They just wake up in the morning and they're doing their thing.
Right, but like I've heard some people say, like, you like this, and therefore that's not logical, and I'm going to sit here and tell you all of the reasons why your decision is not logical until you agree with me.
Well, a Vulcan
like,
wouldn't
well,
have...
I just like this, and we're going to agree to disagree, okay, and then I get up and leave the room, like, and they're still trying to tell me all the reasons I'm wrong for liking something that they don't like.
Yeah, but a Vulcan wouldn't do that, first of all. They tell you once and expect you to understand it. Second of all, Vulcans don't have... opinions of right or wrong on things that you consider like opinion. If it's like a certain music you like to listen to and they don't particularly like it,
so
they'll
Vulcans
just say,
realize that like, there are things that are subjective and not everything is an objective
say,
reality.
That's interesting.
Yeah, Vulcans aren't Aspies as much as Aspies are Aspies, apparently.
Okay.
Yep.
In a room full of libertarians.
Good
we're
job,
really
Shauna. She hit it. Hit the nail on the head.
I like how we're talking about this like it's real.
What, Aspies or
no,
Vulcans?
No, it's totally
which one's
real.
Not real.
Both.
I've interacted with assholes that tell me that I've got the wrong opinion on something because everything must be objective, and if I like something that they don't like, then I'm not logical or something.
Did we switch minds or something? Because I'm pretty sure I call you an Aspie a lot.
You
for getting caught up in being too rational or too caught up in where the train's going or something.
Yes, Daryl, of course, has
so if
aspirates.
You want an apology from me for it, you're not getting it.
Ooh.
I'm not even talking about you.
All right, good.
Well, I didn't want to say anything, guys, but I have mind, to
You didn't
want to
say anything
off.
Nice?
I didn't want to say anything, guys, but I have to take off.
Oh, and okay.
Yeah,
Ellen,
I do
good. We were going to kick you off in like 5 minutes anyway.
Well, good.
You'd got things to do, more important things than hanging out with a bunch of black sheep.
Old people.
Oh, I thought you were going to say black. What? Black sheep
oh,
matter,
wow.
too.
You're racist
black
now?
Sheep matter, too. Okay?
All sheep matter.
All right. Well, thanks so much for having me on
racist.
Again.
All diseases matter.
Thanks for
matter.
Being on, and come visit us more often. I don't even know where you are right now. Don't tell
I,
us.
I live in
She's
the Concord
the
area.
The
I live in the Concord area, so not that far. As I used to.
Well, and do you ever visit us, or are you busy doing? You're doing school and stuff.
It's, yeah, school
she just sits
and show
home
stuff.
And stares at her Tupperware that belongs to thinking other about people, and is what'll, like, what'll yes, make a better mine, mine now.
She goes to Concord Commuter College.
It's not in
of
Concord.
Chemistry.
It's on the seacoast.
You go to Quad C, Concord Commuter College of Chemistry.
Yeah, yeah.
One day
exactly.
she's gonna join Big Pharma, work from within, and fix all these problems.
Yeah. I kind of envision
Thank
myself
so
more as
that.
Like a rogue drug dealer type. But
medicinal magic mushroom.
Ellen, thanks so much for being on.
Yeah, thank you.
And
good to see you guys, Daryl.
Good to see you as well.
Conan, Shauna especially.
Oh. Take it easy.
Yeah, you too.
I feel like, you know, the Tin Man or the Cowardly Lion at the end of The Wizard of Oz, where she says, I'm going to miss all of you, but Scarecrow, you most of all. And it's like Cowardly Lion and Tin Man are like, what the fuck are we? Sliced liver?
Exactly.
If he only had a brain. But since he doesn't have a brain, now he's the Speaker of the House in Congress.
All right, we need to take a break real quick. We're going to leave you with a nice song here. It's by FXUEM. Probably pronounced fuck 'em. And the song is called Pussyfoot. This is extended version. Guys, we'll see you right after this song.
If that's where it's located, you definitely need to go see a doctor. We'll be right back.
do it live.
Do you guys have drops of me?
Actually, so welcome back, everyone. I hope you enjoyed the song. We have a guest on, another past panelist. We dragged him back on. It's Kane Vinchin. We've got a lot of friends, old friends, all in the same room. Of course, I'm talking about...
All right. Executive order number one. Time for some crazy shit.
It's Bert Bernhardt. I don't. Do you recognize where that came from?
It must have been on the time I was on your show.
Nope. Right? Nope. That was one of your older podcasts that I listened to a couple years ago. It was a series on education. Of course, that's what you specialize in at your studio. Which is a School Sucks podcast.
The School Sucks podcast, yes.
And now is it a or is there a the in front, or is it just School Sucks podcast?
We call it the School Sucks Project, and the podcast is part of it, but it's just called School Sucks Podcast.
Wasn't there some domain name you were trying to get or couldn't get because it's unavailable or?
Yeah, School Sucks.
Just that.
Yeah, somebody bought that in like 1992. So
there was internet in 1992.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah.
It was nice.
I thought it came out in like 94.
I don't know. There was this thing called eWorld. I remember that. Maybe this was 1993. And you'd open it up and it was a little world, like a globe. Mm-hmm. And on top there was a city. And you could click. One would say entertainment. And one would say sports. And one would say news. And one would say weather. And you could click on the buildings and it would open just like a list of things you could see.
You know, I remember that my first interactions with the internet were playing the HUD games. Mm-hmm.
Housing and Urban Development.
You walk. I think they were called HUD. You walk into a village and you've got a left sign and a right sign, and there's a sparrow on the bench. What do you do? And if you type in the right commands, you can interact with this world. So it was it was kind of a role playing game, but it was very linear. It was very set. Everything was set up for you. No one knows what I'm talking about.
No.
So
not at all. Like I remember playing. Where in the world is Carmen Sandiego and Oregon Trail on computers?
But this was an online game. It was actually other people walking around. So it was.
I thought you said it was you walking around.
But you can interact with other online players.
You know they were other online players and not just part of the game?
Because someone would show up. You would see their name, just like in a chat group. It was like a. You would enter different rooms too, so you can be there. Could be the whole world, and then you would actually enter into rooms or like a village.
This sounds way too advanced for early
internet.
This is
old. This is really old school internet.
What year roughly?
Maybe 94, 95. I mean, really, we're talking ancient-y stuff.
Oh, but look at us now, huh?
Look at us now. I mean, here I am trying to get get our voices to come out of the stupid monitors over here, but I.
We can discover water on Mars, but Conan can't figure out how to get our voices to go out of the speaker.
We have the technology.
Obviously, I don't have the technology this evening. Speaking of technology...
That's a kind of... What fallacy would that be?
Which one?
We can put a man on the moon, but we can't figure out how to make a microwave do blah, blah, blah.
I think that's the believing what the government tells you fallacy.
Yes,
right, but no, like... there is... Right, because there is no moon.
I think there's a moon. It's probably just a reptilian spaceship, though.
Yeah,
there's a fallacy to where you're like, we can do this, but we can't do this other thing that is totally unrelated.
I think it's called the Rena fallacy, named after my mom, just bitching about things that have no connection to each other.
I want to say it's like a false comparison, but I know there's a better
that
name
sounds analogy? That sounds right. False comparison analogy.
Yeah.
Or fallacy.
But that's not what it's called, but it's something like that.
False finality.
They're looking at this Dyson sphere that's 6 million miles away or something. And they're trying to.
Dyson sphere's inside that vacuum cleaner, and that's why there's no bag.
They're trying to determine what is blocking out the sunlight from coming from this star system, and they can't. Send an orb out, a probe over to the moon so we can get a good look at the footprints and the flag and all, which is what I'm interested
comparison
in.
Comparison fallacy.
Oh, really?
No, I don't know. It was the same thing. But go ahead. I'm interested. This is one of the things I'm interested in.
Well, just recently, there's a Russian group. I think they're all just graduated.
They're
young guys. And they are working on they have a fundraiser, crowdfunding to... purchase and develop a rocket with a nice camera on it, a probe, and they're going to send it over to the moon, and they're going to map the whole thing, maybe we'll get down to the bottom of whether there's a flag and some footprints on the moon. Period.
Flag probably wouldn't be there anymore. The story is that
that's because we never landed because there is no moon.
But I mean, it's got to be somewhere. Maybe it fell over.
If the official story is true, what is believed that happened, because most of the things that were going on were in a fairly close proximity to each other, mm-hmm. that when the lander took off, the force blew the flag over because the flag was barely sticking in the ground anyway.
But there should be a blast-off crater then, at least.
I don't think it would be there anymore. Well, maybe. Possibly. Why
it's
got to
be
it?
Something. There's got to be some space junk or some Land Rover tracks, because they migrated off from the landing spot and the takeoff spot. So there's got to be something,
right? Because there's no wind, obviously. So the tracks would most likely still be there.
There was an episode of MythBusters where they did something, sending a laser up to the moon, and because part of it came back at a certain spot, they're like, this is where they left that lander thing, and so therefore, real.
If you look at the pictures they have now available, they indicate that certain formations are, launch areas or footprints and stuff,
mm-hmm.
and tracks. But I mean, what do I know? I mean, they were really blurry, far off pictures.
Well, that's the problem. That's what makes it such a compelling conspiracy theory, is what do any of us know? No. And that's why the
moon... And like you said, I mean, the moon really could be a big block of cheese. I mean, what do we know? I've never been there. I've never stood on it.
And the Earth is really flat, and there's no South Pole on the flat Earth, and blah, blah, blah.
I've never been to the other side of the Earth either, so how do I know it's round?
Work.
I've never gone around the Earth. I just have to take someone's word for it and the books.
I believe that.
I do too, but I mean, it's
what,
still...
What, the Earth is flat or round?
No, round. I'm a round earther.
I'm iffy on gravity.
Because
gravity is just a theory.
Because it doesn't always work for
you? It's not the law. It's a theory.
No, just that it's like the way that it's thought of as like gravity makes this thing go through nothing. And I think there's kind of something to the idea that there is something there. It's not so much a negation as a positive. And that does change what it actually is.
There was something I was watching where they created like an artificial zero atmosphere something another, and they dropped a bowling ball and a feather at the same time, and because it was like the zero atmosphere thing, they fell at the same rate.
Mm-hmm. With no air resistance. Yeah.
Yeah, it was incredibly interesting.
And they played some nice hippie music over top of it. It was a very neat video.
Well, I'm interested in space. I think that space is the frontier that's really going to challenge a lot of scientific theory the further we explore. And I mean, unfortunately, I don't think we're going to get very far in our own lives. You know, I don't think we're going to see much more.
You think we're going to run out of money for funding such events?
I just don't see, like, with the current technology, that when I say we, I mean humans.
The four people at this table. Yeah, we do not have the money to send out space exploration probes.
The closest star is 4 light years away. Wow. The closest star in space is 4 years at the speed of light. So it's kind of discouraging to think about. We may never see what's that. I mean, the best hope that I think we have in our lifetimes is one of Jupiter's moons is called Europa.
Mm-hmm.
And are you guys familiar with Europa? And they're going to try and go there and drill because it appears to have an ice surface. And the ice also appears to move.
I drink your milkshake.
Is it Europa or another one that has oil, allegedly?
That would probably be another one, but I'm not sure which
one. Oh, Titan, maybe.
Maybe, possibly.
Yeah, Titan needs some freedom.
Well, they're claiming...
The U.S. military needs to go deliver freedom to Titan.
Ah.
Because of oil.
Well, I would more like to see this, like them get under the ice in Europa and see what's there. Because if it is anything like water, there's a good chance that maybe something lives there. And I think that would be very cool. And I think there's plenty of interesting landscapes in our own solar system. I thought the pictures that recently came back from Pluto were absolutely amazing. I don't know if you guys saw those, but you thought Pluto was just like this kind of dark, barren rock out in space, but the landscape of the planet was very interesting. So,
what do you think about like ocean exploration, like actually taking advantage of, you know, there's lots of real estate there.
Yeah,
it's just not being used at all. And there are lots of places we don't even know of, you know, as far as the charting the bottom of the ocean.
Yeah, I've heard that most of the people believe that most of what lives in the ocean is still undiscovered.
It seems every time they go down with one of their little underwater probes, they come back up with a dozen new, you know, organisms that they were unaware of.
Yeah, I think most of the big stuff they probably already have seen. I don't know. I don't know. I'm just guessing.
There's probably something that could like swallow a tiger shark whole that lives somewhere in the ocean and nobody's just ever seen it.
I hope there's stuff in the sky. That's what I'm rooting for.
Floating cities?
Because we can breathe.
They found those in China, apparently. There was some kind of weird thing to where people were reporting, like, floating cities in China.
Oh, yeah. The silly...
and then there was some kind of thing of...
Some camcorder guy.
This is Project Bluebeam, and they're doing tests to show that they can actually make people see floating stuff, and that's how Jesus is going to come back.
Well, do we want to get into that? Because that's an interesting one.
Yeah, I mean, as far as the actual story and whether it's even real or not, because this has happened two times where someone has caught a mirage-looking floating city above the actual city. Let me bring that up. Maybe.
Yeah, let's have a look at that because I don't know anything about this.
Yeah, and then apparently, it happened in the UK a couple days later. Mm-hmm. To where like thousands of people reported seeing this city floating in the clouds.
Maybe it's like that level on Chrono Trigger where you're up in the air.
Yeah, I don't know. Maybe one guy saw it and then other people were like, yeah, I saw that too.
Well, I think there's a lot of that. There was one in Phoenix, the Phoenix Lights.
All right, I just clicked on the first video. This is 6:21. I want to actually see the footage.
With lights lit up, signs.
Okay, it's a very Alex Jones sounding.
America.
There you go.
America.
You say UK. Shared this on Twitter.
Of course, you paused it.
And said, "Look at this! People pointing to the sky, and look what it is."
Floating city.
It's a floating city.
Well, you better zoom.
It looks like a floating castle.
This is the exact same structure that you see above China.
Oh, so this sounds like it's another video.
The building there. So, I messaged the colorists of the world.
So this is the original, and I guess maybe they found another one since this one came out.
You could see this right here.
But I'm thinking of all the video editors out there that, you know.
And it shows that the Chinese could change the
Now this is just a picture.
It looks like a screenshot from a video.
Yep. I've learned from the world of adult entertainment online, you never trust a picture.
Because it's been enhanced and enlarged cleaned up.
I need to see video.
Yeah. Well,
I've seen every headline I've seen is thousands report seeing. But, yeah, like I could say like I reportedly saw a Loch Ness Monster in the swimming pool of the Best Western. And there's nobody there to say, like, you didn't actually see the whatever.
Well, this is more convincing.
That's just them moving the camera at a picture. And then talking in Chinese, like saying,
are there more videos of that?
That is the only one. And you would think that, I mean, so everyone's got cameras these days. If the city is that big over that big of a city, someone else got some footage.
Well, like, you've got more than just one angle of this thing.
This is the only available video.
Couldn't it be like the equivalent of lights in the sky at night? You just have like colors implanted onto, because it's not a cloudless sky. I mean, you have a cloudy day and you just beam up your image or projection onto.
Or you could just do some video editing.
I mean, what are people saying is the point of this? That this is the reason why the government has the chemtrails or something?
Something talking about Project Bluebeam. And
what's Project Bluebeam?
Something to where the Illuminati can project images into the sky and make people have mass hallucinations, and that's how Jesus comes back.
Well, it's not the Illuminati. It would just be like the governments, right?
The governments being controlled by the Illuminati.
Exactly, the puppet masters.
Well, why would the Illuminati want Jesus to come back, or people to think Jesus to come back, if he's a different king?
I don't
know. Of kings, not subject to them. So I mean,
the Antichrist, and he's going to be a direct puppet of the Illuminati to save us from the coming collapse, which is going to come, right?
Well,
we're going to need someone to pick up all the pieces who's going to save us.
Wernher von Braun, who was, again, there's a lot of you're really into the territory of the alleged when you're talking about this stuff. But I'm actually, I don't want to use Rational Wiki. I want to use Wikipedia for Project Blue Beam.
He does not want to use rationalism at all when talking
Wiki
about conspiracy
kind of
theories.
Like a skeptic echo chamber where, like, you know, skeptics are kind of like, it's a similar thing with atheists and maybe some libertarians. It's like, oh, if I get into this, I'm smarter than everybody, you know?
And so, some conspiracy theorists.
And yeah, absolutely. So it's... atheists, conspiracy theorists, skeptics, it's kind of a nice cudgel to hit people with and feel superior to them intellectually. That's why I got into all those things. So I'm waiting for the paper.
So you're a skeptical atheist conspiracy theorist?
I don't like the term skeptic. I mean, I think we're all...
This got you into it, the superiority complex. Is it? Are you still, now that you know what you know, are you glad that you did it, and now you're not necessarily trying to know more and be better than
your
peers?
Absolutely not. I mean, my tone has completely changed. But I mean, the first one was obviously conspiracy theories, and I don't know. I mean, I was a teacher, so I guess I was always kind of into the idea of like, well, I'll talk and people will listen.
And that's there's no better way to get the attention of some youngins than to say something off the wall like that. And it's like, oh, wait, hoax moon landing? What? What did you just say? And he's a teacher and an adult?
I actually did that. We watched a moon landing. Was the moon landing a hoax video in a history class that I taught? And I wasn't saying, hey, look, I believe this and you should too. I was just like, let's, you know.
Hey, we've got some time.
Yeah, this is
Hey, open. Let's broaden our horizons. Let's look, you know, broaden our minds and maybe think about this at another angle.
Yeah, it was like a Friday afternoon video type thing. But anyway, Wernher von Braun, who was a rocket scientist who came here from a definitely a real project called Project Paperclip.
Yeah.
When the Americans brought a bunch of Nazis here after World War II to work on a variety of... scientific applications, including
like rockets that we as in U.S. couldn't get to work.
Right, exactly. So,
and the Germans knew how to do that because they had already sent the moon Nazis up to the moon before the end of World War II.
Well, they had all that alien
technology. It's all in Iron Sky. Watch the movie, people.
It was something that there was a lot of fear about. In reality, I mean, the Iron Sky was based on real fears that the Nazis were going to go to the moon and build a base there, and whoever controls space controls the Earth.
And they've got helium-3 mines.
Wait. So was it putting satellites in orbit, or was it actually going to the moon and setting up missile structures there?
That was something that they were it was a design they had, was to go to the, and they had a lot of interesting aircraft that was I mean, they were cultists, you know, like they believed in you know, they're going to India and measuring people's heads and trying to find the Aryan race, and they were wacky occult people who are at the top of the Nazi party, and most of them had, you know, post-traumatic stress disorder. Not that that makes them wacky, but yeah, they also were dealing with that from World War I. But von Braun, who was their Nazi, one of their top scientists, came to the United States and started working on projects that ultimately evolved into the Apollo program. And he told people that first they'll use communism, then they'll use terrorism, and then they'll use asteroids, and then they'll use aliens.
So he missed global warming.
Oh,
maybe he didn't foresee that.
Right, but we've got the terrorist and the global warming happening at the same time. So maybe it's the terrorist causing the global warming.
Maybe asteroids is kind of a natural incident. I mean, so is, you know, climate change.
Mm-hmm.
So you can kind of maybe tie that into the same group.
Right.
Very interesting. I wasn't aware of that. I knew they'll try communism.
Well, the terrorist fear has kind of diminished, I think, for most people, especially like in the public consciousness. Like,
it's getting stale.
It's stale, right? And nothing new has really happened, and you know, Al Qaeda kind of disappeared. Actually,
well, tonight's the night that all of the anarchists are supposed to go out wearing masks and something that was proven to be a complete fabricated story made up by the New York Post, but news media outlets are still running with it.
You still have domestic terrorists. You still have all the school shootings. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, that doesn't seem to be declining. It seems about the same.
But even shootings don't have that impact anymore. You know, I mean, you look at something that as tragic as Sandy Hook, where you're talking like over 20 children mm-hmm. getting killed. And people were, you know, affected by that for a month, 2 months. So I think if these things are made up, let's say, if these are false flag or whatever people want to believe, they have to be basically continuous and they have to intensify. And the threat has to loom and loom and loom. And since 9/11, there hasn't been anything like that.
Yeah. And, of course, yeah, looking at all the ISIS videos that have come out, I mean, very, very bizarre and horrible executions. And, you know, I remember the guy getting burned, and I just stopped watching him after that. I don't even read him anymore, because I myself, not only are they wretched, I just don't want to know anything about him. But they're so, I don't know. It is getting old.
Yeah, people are just desensitized to it.
And maybe that's the point. Maybe that's maybe one of the objectives is to for people to lose their to lose touch with how horrible they really are. So when the next level of horribleness happens, they'll be ready for it.
Yeah, there's also a lot of theory about predictive programming. Like, people think this stuff is really far out. Like, things will show up in movies. There's these wacky 9/11 videos where they go through all these pop culture references to the numbers 9/11 or to the Twin Towers.
Or like the Simpsons with the 9/11 or the...
Take a bus tour. A bus!
Or a big...
The terrorist did not use buses, so, like, if that was predicting something, well, they were off by the mode of transportation.
Mm-hmm. But it says New York 9/11 and the
no,
towers.
It says $9 bus rides, and the 9 is next to the towers, and they're saying the towers form the 11.
Yep.
It's a very convincing 9/11.
And people, hey, if people want to do this, I'm not trying to scare
Neo's
anyone.
Passport expires on 9/11/01.
Back to the Future.
Back to the connection with the guy's new movie that's coming out, or it came out on the, what was the 9/11? What was the Back to the Future date? 25th?
October 21st.
So the directors and the director, I forget his name already.
Zemeckis.
Back to the
Zemeckis
Future.
Did another movie on the towers, on the Twin Towers, and a guy is tightroping across him. I don't know the backstory at all, but it came out on the 25th, and it's supposed to be his connection. Somehow he knew about. I guess we're talking about different Back to the Future.
This guy also, the dude that made Back to the Future also did Interstate 60. So is Interstate 60 somehow supposed to be predictive programming that some interstate that doesn't exist is going to blow up the Twin Towers? Like, I don't understand.
No, I mean, but Back to the Future, so you have this attempt throughout the struggle of the protagonist is to warn somebody else about this event that's going to happen in the future,
yeah.
Right? And he tries to do it at the Twin Pines Mall, and the whole event is about a strike on a landmark building.
When it comes
building.
Back, it changes from Twins to the Pines.
To Lone Pine, yeah,
Lone Pine Mall.
Ran over one of the fucking trees, you dumbass.
But then
he ran over one of the trees.
You can watch
He didn't
the
run
video.
Over both of the trees. It didn't go to No Pines.
Okay, but when he
it
leaves...
It didn't go to, you know... Pine number 7 was an inside job.
When he
Stop
leaves,
your nonsense.
When he leaves 1955 and the car makes those burn. I'm not saying I believe any of this. I just think this is a lot
you
of fun.
You got a very, yeah, yeah. You got the 9 sign
in
and
the
you
right,
got the two stripes.
In the right-hand corner of the screen, left-hand corner of the screen, there's a big 9. And then his two tire tracks with the flames make the 11.
It's there, Daryl. It's very convincing.
Now, yeah, and you can find
fucking
phallic...
when you're
things
when
you, inside ice cubes of the Coca-Cola thing, if that's what the fuck you're looking
when
for.
If
you're looking for something, you can fucking find any damn thing.
When you already know exactly,
for.
When you already know the answer and you're looking for that answer, you're gonna find it somewhere. It is gonna that answer is in a pattern on the wall right over here. And if I look hard enough, I'll find it.
I wonder if all these things are like a parody of confirmation bias.
Yes.
Like the Shining Code. Have you guys ever heard of the Shining Code?
Kubrick getting his nice fancy schmancy camera to film 2001 was a deal with NASA. So he
and he tells the story in The Shining, allegedly.
Yeah,
he gives up all the information in The Shining. Exactly.
Right. So the guy who made The Shining Code, he's like,
here's Johnny,
also looking for 11s because of Apollo 11.
Yeah.
Now the scene where the kid stands up on the
that very convincing when he's walking
he's
down
the Apollo 11
and he's walking by the room. What was the name of the room? It was the Moon Room or something.
236.
Yeah, oh, yeah, and in the book stuff. It was supposed to be another room number, and so therefore that confirms that Stanley Kubrick was an inside job.
It's all, well, this story is interesting. If like you, the more of the story you know, unfortunately, it's like one of those things where you're like, oh, shit, this is kind of weird. But, you know, what's the point? I mean, even if you had ultimately proof, no one would believe you.
No.
Everyone
believes that Kennedy was assassinated by someone inside job like, and probably not the lone gunman. And yet,
it doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter anymore. It's so old.
And one of the CIA guys confessed on his deathbed. Yeah. E. Howard Hunt.
I mean, even the 9/11. I mean, if they were to come out today and prove that, yeah, it was definitely an inside job. Bush knew, Cheney knew, they all knew. They set it up. They had planned years in advance. And
Patriot Act doesn't go away.
They pulled. Yeah, exactly.
NSA doesn't go away. Edward Snowden's still going to be charged with espionage.
Yeah.
Private Manning's still going to be in prison for the next 30-some-odd years.
So I've always said that if one of these crazy incidents happens, we have to come get to the bottom of it. You know, within that year,
mm-hmm.
While it's still fresh
to...
in everyone's mind. Otherwise, it's not. It's meaningless.
Let's look at something even more recent: the bombing of the Doctors Without Borders hospital in Kunduz, Afghanistan, that happened October 3rd.
Yeah, but it didn't happen on our soil, though, and it wasn't.
It happened by the U.S. fucking military.
Yeah, but it didn't
bombing
happen.
A fucking hospital, and now the U.S. military is trying to destroy. Dude, you can't bomb fucking hospitals.
You sure can. Look it. Here's a hospital.
They
We're
going
to fucking bomb
away
it.
With it.
So, and there's nothing conspiratorial about that. It's just they did it, and okay, I guess that's a hospital that you have to bomb.
And
the thing with the movies of like, oh, look at this Robert Zemeckis movie. Look at that one. So what? I haven't seen that one, but any of these movies that I see that you find out later, oh, look, it was talking about 9/11. So? I watch it for the first time,
the
and
Bible
I don't
Code
notice.
Guys.
It's not like the Bible Code guys. With these movies,
it is because you can't find these hidden Bible clues unless you type in what you're
unless
looking
looking for.
What is the Bible Code?
I
don't know if it's
the
actual.
They're taking the Torah and they.
They've got a program where they put all the letters.
I think it's
in a grid, and then you search for different things.
Hyper
like,
academic realization of the idea that the Bible has. Good ideas for how to live. And then
the way,
I guess people take from there to, oh, well, you know, should I invest in this stock or something?
Oh,
so like you
I don't actually know. I mean, I know they had something on Oprah. I guess they watch more Oprah than I do or something.
No, but we had Joe on the show. Joe was talking about the Bible Code on Mirzoff.
Oh, okay.
And apparently there's some kind of program to where you can set it up on a grid, like, you know, 20 by 20 or 50 by whatever. And then you search for words.
It'll,
and
it'll
it will
try to
show,
find your search query
yeah,
in
like,
a pattern. So it'll
this know, word appears 5 times in the span of this block of text, and it appears next to this word, so therefore this. And it's always this sort of backwards compatible sort of thing to where, oh, well, we found out that it shows this, this, and this, so therefore it was warning that... this guy was going to be assassinated because it says whatever.
So it's like numerology, basically.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But the thing I was going to say about the bombing of the hospital is now the U.S. government is doing everything it can to prevent an independent investigation. They even smashed a tank into the rubble to destroy whatever evidence was left.
Oh, good heavens.
Yeah.
It didn't.
Doesn't sound like there's any conspiracy at all. It's just we bombed it. We're covering it up, and there you go. I mean, the thing about the movies that prove stuff that happened in the past is so frustrating because it's kind of a circle jerk of who's the cleverest. And I guess that's what you were saying earlier about showing up. Because, like, if I watch a movie right now that comes out, that came out yesterday, what am I going to look for? Am I going to look for some event that's upcoming? If I see numbers in a curtain or something, and I'll be like, oh my God, on March 14th, I got to be ready and buy seeds and all that. And if you watched...
That isn't how the world works, pal.
If you watch a second Back to the Future back then, you're not going to know something's going to happen on 9/11. They're not warning you of anything.
Right.
They're not, you know, and the same thing about the Apollo 11 in the Stanley Kubrick movie. It doesn't tell you anything.
I have been expecting there like 15 more Jaws movies.
Great. That's really great. And there are, you know, people say like, oh, well, it's, you know, prophecy. And like there are prophecies, like I guess in the Bible where he's saying like this precisely will happen. But then it comes in the translators or traders, so you don't really know today, and it doesn't matter. So, I mean, what I want to see is somebody, you know, taking a current movie and saying, this is going to predict, you know, something happening.
Exactly.
And look at all the numbers here. Doing the exact same thing with something like the Back to the Future movie, which was fun. I mean, for a conspiracy movie that debunks everything and shows y'all how it really is, it was actually really nice and pleasant. It had this huge, you know, intertitle about how Robert Zemeckis is a great guy and he moves through art through time. It was pretty neat.
Mm-hmm.
But to do that with current movies or something, and not, you know, so that I can be prepared for the times to come.
Well, there are people like Gerald Celente that predict every major economic collapse plus about 1,000 that have never happened. So, like, the whole prediction.
And Max Kaiser is telling us all that, you know, all the silver investments are going to pay off soon too. So I mean,
yeah.
So you're saying if we had like a Gerald Celente of movies, who was right?
So can he make movies
until then everyone should just shut the fuck up about it, because
exactly.
You're right, like Back to the Future Part 2 or Back to the Future Part 1 came out in 1985. Nobody even would have known to look for things like that in movies, and it wasn't
unless
like,
they had the search words to input into the movie once they started watching.
Why would you watch the second Back to the Future, for example, and look for the 9/11s and see the two lines and be like, oh, that's two lines. Maybe it's one big bar.
Yeah, you'd have to. Like, the only time where this would even be possible is now, right? Or, in the recent times to, like, watch movies trying to figure out if they're communicating a message. I think the only thing that's interesting, and it's certainly not academic at all, and it's certainly probably not even a rational use of a person's time, is to try and discover, it's like one of these things, like any conspiracy, wouldn't it be neat if this was true? Yeah. Wouldn't this be exciting if this was true?
And then you prove yourself right, and everyone who doubted you is now you're underneath you.
But is it that there is in the entertainment industry some kind of...
Cabal.
That knows what's going to happen. Because, I mean, if you look at this, like, how do they slip the 9/11 thing into an episode of The Simpsons? Like, how would that even happen?
Or Big Lebowski when he's signing the check. And it's,
yeah. Like, and make sure you put lots of 9/11s in your stuff, guys. There's, like, a 9/11 quota from the Screen Actors Guild. Like, how many times... Or the Screenwriters Guild. Like, how many times it has to appear in things. Yeah, it's silly. I can't think of any way
maybe,
that would
maybe,
happen.
Maybe it's a universal thing. Maybe our whole belief system, our bodies, our world that we live on is all based on this 9/11. It's within us.
I'm going to call it semiotics.
Right, but like if something major would have happened on May 5th in 2005, people would go back and say that every movie since like the 1960s has been predicting it because all of the telephone numbers in movies are 555.
Yep.
Well, think about when you're writing, like in The Big Lebowski, he writes the date, right? 9/11.
I have no clue what happened.
And
it should.
You should watch it. You'll learn a lot. Mm-hmm. When you're writing it down, and the camera will show your circle, and then down, and then down, and then down, and the date is done. And that's very pleasing to watch, and it has a lot of closure in watching a date being written.
Wait.
And even when you're looking at it, you have the 9 that has the loop, and then it goes down, and 11, it's bigger then because the month should be smaller.
I like this idea. So let's say that the...
And that's what, it's just an easy standard to be writing.
Yeah,
you have exactly. three the numbers creators, to write, the, so you're
the media
busy.
Media creators have chosen this. It's pleasing to the eye. It sounds good. And the Illuminati puppet masters... They're trying to decide what day, and oh, hey, look at all these 9/11s that have popped up that the media have chosen to be their number.
I mean, Daryl's example
ahead and
of May
to what they've already discovered is pleasing to the eye.
I mean, Daryl's example of May 5th is terrible because there's too many loops, there's too many swirls, and it's just a clusterfuck.
Right, but then there's also the what telephone number do you call if you have an emergency? 911. So there's another implied meaning to the numbers 911.
Mm-hmm. Well, so, on a rotary phone, that's the fastest.
Right, but no, what I'm saying is if somebody sees 911 up on a screen, their initial thought is going to be emergency, danger. It's not going to be, oh, something bad is going to happen on September 11th somewhere. Like, they're not necessarily thinking of a date. They're thinking, you know, like, emergency,
Brett,
danger.
Out of all of the big conspiracy theories that are floating out there, and there's a lot of them, which ones do you want to find the answers to it, to be laid out on the table, all answers available to us? Which one do you think would be more meaningful?
I think that the assassinations are the most important ones. The assassinations that took place in the 1960s, and then if you look at the impact of those three events, Kennedy, King, and then Kennedy
right.
again, and then the moon landing. Happens at the end of
so it'll
this
be a it'll be a
tragic,
effect.
Disastrous decade. You know?
We have overcome this adversity and these national disasters
and you,
to show that what Kennedy said in 1961 has come to fruition, that we would put a man on the moon by the end of the decade.
But yeah, but it was just that if you understand the urgency of that event in that context, so you have race riots. Yeah. Breaking out in cities were a year away. I mean, this didn't precede the moon landing, but it was a year. The environment was such that a year later, the National Guard shot college students on a college campus. So the country was getting ready to burn, you know, and when people look at that event in the context of those assassinations where, I mean, you imagine like these Obama style hope balloons being inflated to just be popped in the most tragic way possible, one after another after another. I mean, within 5-6 years of each other.
Right.
Okay,
right.
So I just want to explain why I'm laughing. I'm not laughing at anything Brett just said. I'm laughing at somebody that just walked into the convention hall dressed as a chronic caller to Free Talk Live. You can find him on YouTube at Hudson Valley Guy New York. Hudson Valley NY1 is another one of them. I found like 6 different channels that he has, and they're all absolutely horrible, but he wears this Angry Birds hat and sunglasses, and he always says, "Why don't you say that to my face?" And he repeats himself, "I am not a leech. I'm not a man child. I've got a job."
So our Halloween costume early.
Somebody came
prepping
early
for this evening's event. Yes. That'll be in this room, right?
No, different location.
Where?
We'll actually be able to have the fog machine this time.
Same. Wait, where? I'm
Elks
clueless.
Lodge.
Okay.
I'm glad I found that out. Because it's already going to have happened.
Right, I care though, because I would have come here and been like, "Where is everybody?"
Yeah, I could have fucking told you off screen, but now we've wasted a minute and a half explaining that something.
Well, Angry Bird
here.
Man ruined Brett's the culmination where he was getting to the bottom of.
Well, I think that understanding that context of those really transformative events in the 1960s is important. I think that at this point we're never going to have the answers to any of these things in a way where everybody agrees and says yes, this is clearly what happens. We've never even gotten close on any of them.
Yeah,
and they're. If you care about history, they're all valuable, the JFK assassination anniversary was like 2 years ago.
If you believe that, to understand history, it will help you better understand the future and your present. But no one, you know, no one cares about that. It doesn't make any sense to them.
Allow me.
Want me to read a history book that's going
to
prove how the future is going to work out?
Allow me to quote V from the movie V for Vendetta. There's no such thing as coincidence, only the illusion of coincidence. And I think that's sort of what you were hitting on, Brett, is like you had all of these events that happen, you know, within a matter of years of one another. And, yeah, it would be nice to think that, oh, well, you know, those were just all coincidence, but maybe they weren't.
I don't think
maybe it's all
were.
Part of a greater master plan.
Right. So that was the thing that always attracted me to the moon landing, which without a tremendous amount of research and scholarship, you couldn't even have the grammar, the information you need to try and figure it, to try and make a rational decision about what happened. There's too much to learn, and that's what makes it such a great conspiracy, is that it's so good to attract lay people who are like, yeah, they can't go through this radiation belt. Yep. Oh, a radiation belt? Yeah, I guess they couldn't go through that. Hmm. You know, like there's so many things that people don't know about astrophysics. The same thing with 9/11. It's never about motives. It's never about anything like that. It's about demolition and physics and things that most people just don't understand. And somebody gets up at a podium and they talk in an authoritative tone about it, whether they're for the official story or against it. And the people who want to believe or don't want to believe find somebody that they can latch onto as an authority. And it's just, you know, an echo chamber of confirmation bias. And I think that's why a lot of people go to this.
I hate those damn echo chambers. You just can't. They're all over the place.
Yeah, I hate them too.
Yeah, they're the worst.
Yeah, absolutely horrible. Echo chambers, much worse than gas chambers.
I'm glad we all agree on that.
Daryl, you want to do What Have You Learned?
Yeah, let's do that.
Okay, so.
We've not done that in a while.
What did you learn?
Brett Vinat, what have you learned since you were last on Black Sheep Rising?
That's a good, long, healthy amount of time.
That is a good, long, healthy amount of time.
I think he just blew his mind. Maybe. What about last week?
All right. Well, we have to kind of set a point. When were you guys dealing with that whole Keene school board thing? Because it was around then.
It was last year.
About a year ago.
Or just tell us a funny story.
Are you
that works,
that?
Too. We just want factoids.
What have I learned? I learned that you need to read the ingredients of food to see what kinds of gums are in it.
Like gums that are holding them together?
Guar gum, xanthan gum. You know, especially if you're trying to lose weight, you want to stay away from gums. So I've learned a little bit about, you know, what I should be eating and what I shouldn't. Back in March, I put on a bunch of weight, and I couldn't figure out why. And I had become addicted to this Carb Smart low carb Breyers ice cream. And I was eating it like every day. I was going through like almost two big boxes of it a week, but it hardly had any carbs in it. And I'm like, what the hell is happening to my body? I'm eating the good ice cream. So I talked to my friend who's kind of a nutrition expert and got on a cleaner diet, lost like 15 pounds, and cut out the gums. And as a general rule, tried to stay away from artificial ingredients in food, processed things in food. Now, I guess I always knew that, but I've been putting it into practice more. I've learned a lot. I've read some books, you know. I mean, in a year.
That's a long time. Why did you put it back so far?
I learned that I liked living in Manchester better than living in King.
Uh-oh.
Boo. Yeah,
well, that sounds really hard to believe.
Daryl, what did you learn?
I learned that apparently Brett thought there was such a thing as healthy ice cream.
Not healthy, but healthier.
I also earlier today learned about Nihilist Arby's, and I actually retweeted a Nihilist Arby's tweet at Jeffrey Tucker because it mentioned McDonald's.
Is that so? You learned that through Bert,
through Bert Vinat.
Is that something you follow? Are there any other good tweeters out there that just they
sweet
drop
meteor
good,
of death 2016
good knowledge or good fun?
Ian Googling.
I like all the fake ones.
Mark Edge Googling.
Evil Jeffrey
Ian
Tucker.
Ian Freeman.
Evil
list.
Jeffrey Tucker is one.
Would you like to hear some evil Jeffrey Tucker?
I would love to hear some evil Jeffrey Tucker.
We'll come back to that.
While Brett is looking, Shauna, what is the one you follow? The duck, the evil duck, or something?
It's really bad and really ungood for liberty, but Jokeocracy.
Jokeocracy.
Yeah, as if it were democracy, but joke, mm-hmm. spelled out, ocracy. It'll make you rethink things. I've been following Nihilist Arby's for a while. Sweet Meteor of Death 2016.
So you already knew about Nihilist.
Yeah, I've retweeted a lot of those on Facebook, or at least posted them.
Only a few hours left to load up on razor blades and pens for your Halloween candies and Plan B pills for your Halloween decisions. Enjoy Arby's.
I don't know. I don't know about this whole tweet crap. It's just
Halloween
is so scary,
mommy. Why, sweetie? The ghost. Oh, ghosts aren't real, baby. When you die, your soul dies, and everyone forgets
what
you.
What did I learn this year? Arby's. I learned that there are some alcohols that I don't wish to imbibe and or deal with, and one of them is
like
the...
ethyl alcohol?
One of them is that cinnamon fireball crap. The last bonfire...
the one where you fell through the chair and off the stairs and lost your glasses?
Completely good to go, and then had a couple shots of the fireball stuff, and it just all... went to black. So fireball, I think. You know, I think other people have come to the same conclusions. It's dangerous stuff. That's what I learned. Shauna, what did you learn?
I've learned very recently that henna, hippie crap you put in your hair to color it, will stay in your hair forever. And there's ways to get it out. I've been trying to do that.
It can't be forever. It's not. That's not how stains
work. I have like 5 different colors in my hair right now. I'm just not very annoying and loud and obnoxious about it, so you can't tell.
Brett, did you find any notables?
Yeah.
Talking to the microphone.
Uh-oh. Yeah, I didn't even realize.
Okay. So Jeffrey Tucker is kind of very optimistic. He's kind of a futurist. On... June 13th, evil Jeffrey Tucker tweets, the ideal McDonald's worker of the future will be faceless. Their pathetic expressions make it harder for me to enjoy my number twos. Meaning the value meal number
twos. I was thinking, all right, they could, because we got other number twos out there.
Catholicism greater than sign Satanism. Both have exquisite pageantry, but Catholicism has better songs. I do long for more human sacrifice rituals, though.
I long for a future where everyone will be mercilessly fucked by robots. Glorious. Hashtag optimism.
Yeah, that's
well, you've heard it from this panel. Brett's favorite tweets coming from those locations. If you want to be like Brett, you need more evil Jeffrey Tucker in your lives, and so get right on that.
Government is out of control. I just learned it's illegal for me to sell chewing tobacco to elementary school students. Hashtag entrepreneurship.
Did you hear that, Ian? Keep the tobacco away from the kiddies when you're passing out pamphlets. Brett, it was so good
looking
to have you
dates.
On.
Absolutely. It was always good to be on with you guys. I enjoyed
it.
It's
too bad you're all the way over there in Manchville, where it's better, I guess.
I like the addition of Shauna to your show. I think that's...
Yes. Aww. Yes. Shauna has... helped Daryl in so many ways. Daryl used to be just he
really
his aspirates. It would kick in every 3 minutes. He'd just be F-bombing and blumpkinfesting and the whole nine.
I've not said blumpkinfest in a long time.
I know. I brought it back.
Blumpkinfesting as a verb.
And Shauna's really put Daryl in his place. So she's a good, definitely a great addition to the.
We definitely need to bring back Blumpkinfest next year so that there can be Blumpkin riots.
Gross. But
if you want to check us out,
Arby's.
If you want to see past videos, they're all there and available. Most of them are on YouTube. All of the audio is there. Some of the videos have been taken down over the years. But blacksheeprising.org is the website. You can also catch us on iTunes and on Stitcher, or you can manually download those audios at the site. Also, check us our Facebook page out. Give us some likes. I do a lot of... I don't know. Facebook is a lot easier to work with than the WordPress. You know, I pretty much just put the nuts and bolts on there. But if you want to see what I'm tweeting on the Facebook, it's going to be there.
You don't tweet.
I know. Whatever.
Facebook.
When I put my posts on the Facebook page.
Have you done a caption this lately?
I haven't, because I actually was working on one. It was going to be you in a suit with tennis shoes on. And I just, man, those things are hard. They can take a long, long portion of a day if I need to do a really good one. And it really depends on what's been going on. And that was really the only notable story. Tell us about the tennis shoes and the suit while I bring something up.
I hate shoes.
You went to a presidential debate with some other libertarians.
And I was wearing shoes that are comfortable, and apparently some people on Facebook took issue with it, and they're like, well, blah, blah, blah.
Was Evil Jeffrey Tucker one of them?
No, because it was on Facebook. Evil Jeffrey Tucker's on Twitter. But somebody was like, well, here's these different CEOs of companies that wear sneakers with their suits. So, like, shut up. Like,
Daryl, where can the people see that presidential debate?
It's on YouTube.
And your site is?
DarylWPerry.com. Also, fpp.cc and fppradio.com.
Sean, if the people are going to find you, where they look?
Well, I do post as Black Sheep Rising sometimes. I can be emailed at applausewithoutcause@blacksheeprising.org.
Brett, your site?
SchoolSucksProject.com, and my YouTube channel is School Sucks Podcast.
Where can they find you on Twitter?
At School Sucks Show.
If you're watching this show, you're probably already aware of Bert and his good works helping society get out of that rut.
Just thought of a parody Twitter account that somebody needs to make, and that would be School Sucks Project Sucks.
Yeah, I'm glad there aren't any parody.
Do you need to take that, grab it up before someone takes it?
Yeah, go ahead.
I'm just throwing it out to the people that run the, you know, Ian Googling, the Mark Googling, the Rebel Luck show.
That's
which
lot
is a
of work.
Parody
it's probably
of
all one
Rebel
guy,
Love,
too. So much work.
Jim Jesus Googling,
he
Ian
have a
Freeman
job.
Wish List, Evil Jeffrey Tucker, Nihilist Arby's.
Brett,
it's probably
thanks so
all
much
the
for
same guy.
On. Hope to see you sometime in the future.
Absolutely. Thank you all for having me on your show.
Guys at home, thank you for watching. We're going to see you next month. We're going to close on Black Bear. It's the IDFC Who Knows remix.
Who knows?
We'll see you next month. Take care.
You love me, even if it's fake, 'cause I don't fucking care at all. You've been out all night, I don't know where you've been. You're slurring all your words, not making any sense, but I don't fucking care at all. 'Cause I have hella feelings for you. Fucking care, like they ain't even there. 'Cause I have hella feelings for you. I act like I don't fucking care, 'cause I'm so fucking scared. I'm only a fool for you. And maybe too good for me. I'm only pretty lies, look me in the face, tell me that you love me, even if it's fake, 'cause I don't fucking care at all. You've been out all night, I don't know where you've been, you're
ever know your words, not making any sense, but I don't fucking care at all. Cause I have hella feelings for you. I act like I don't fucking care, like they ain't even there. Cause I have hella feelings for you. I act like I don't fucking care, cause I'm so fucking scared. I'm only cause I have feelings for you. I act like I don't fucking care, like they ain't even there.
Alderaan? What are you talking about?
Star Wars.
Star Wars.
Oh, okay.